Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship this morning as we gather for a service of Holy Communion. We'll be following Divine Service setting number 3 in the hymnal this morning. And we are drawing closer and closer to Christmas. This is the second of the 4 Sundays of the Advent season. And we are going to have a children's message this morning after the initial part of the service. And then the children will depart to Sunday school. There are elections being held today, so that will follow the service. Please stay. Will the elections be here, or will they be in the fellowship hall?
Fellowship hall.
Go to the fellowship hall for the elections this morning after the service. And if you would like to order poinsettias and wreaths from Trinity's youth group, this is the last Sunday to do that. They will be delivered next week. Let us now stand as we begin our service, singing hymn 344, On Jordan's Bank, the Baptist's Cry. Beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sin.
O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you,
and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment.
But I am heartily sorry for them,
this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually.
Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he has uttered.
In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Somebody has done something wrong, maybe directly to you, you could say, that was wrong, but I forgive you. And we can forgive because Jesus has forgiven us. And that makes us his disciples, And Jesus' disciples go out and speak good news to the people that your sins are forgiven. So this key will then unlock the gates of heaven for those people. So that is the number one thing we need to remember as Christians. The key to heaven is forgiveness for us and for other people too. All right, thank you for coming up, and have a good practice session this morning, and we'll see you in a couple of weeks.
The Old Testament reading for the second Sunday in Advent is from Isaiah chapter 11. There shall come forth a shoot from the stump of Jesse, and a branch from his root shall bear fruit. And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. And his delight shall be in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide disputes by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall kill the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his waist, and faithfulness the belt of his loins. The wolf shall dwell with the lamb, and the leopard shall lie down with the young goat, and the calf and the lion fattened calf together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, their young shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw like the ox. The nursing child shall play over the hole of the cobra, and the weaned child shall put his hand on the adder's den. They shall not hurt or destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord, as the waters cover the sea. In that day the root of Jesse shall stand as a signal for the peoples. Of him shall the nations inquire, and his resting place shall be glorious. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from Romans chapter 15. Whatever was written in the former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the scriptures we might have hope. May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ became a servant to the circumcised to show God's truthfulness, in order to confirm the promise given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for his mercy. As it is written, therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles and sing your name. And again it is said, rejoice, O Gentiles, with the people. And again, praise the Lord, all you Gentiles, and let all peoples extol him. And again Isaiah says, the root of Jesse will come, even he who arises to rule the Gentiles, in him will the Gentiles hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand as we sing the Alleluias. John wore a garment of camel's hair and a leather belt around his waist, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region about the Jordan were going out to him, and they were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees coming for baptism, he said to them, "You brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruit in keeping with repentance, and do not presume to say to yourselves, 'We have Abraham as our father.' For I tell you, God is able from those stones to raise up children for Abraham. Even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. I baptize you with water for repentance, but he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand, and he will clear his threshing floor and gather his wheat into the barn, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. This is the gospel of the Lord." Our faith, speaking the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all the worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended to heaven, and sit at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will not have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and Redeemer of our life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Congregation, please be seated as we sing hymn 331, the Advent of God.
Thank you.
and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The text for the sermon is the Old Testament reading from Isaiah. You may be seated. In the Lutheran service book, there's a hymn that has a title, In Adam's Fall, All Mankind Fell. Well, that is the depth of this issue that we have with sin. The story of the fall into sin, Genesis chapter 3, it's not just a cautionary tale about resisting temptation. We shouldn't just feel bad for them. We shouldn't just feel bad that Eve was tempted and that Adam was then complicit, or that they were cast out of this beautiful Garden of Eden. Like almost every story in the Bible, that story is about us and about all humans. Though it was not literally our hand that reached out to pick the tempting fruit, and it wasn't our mouth that defied God's warning by biting into the deadly flesh, and it wasn't our foolish attempt to hide from God and then only grudgingly admit that we put our trust into Satan and his lies instead of God's truth. That may not have literally been us there, but that is our sin right there in the open. For we have inherited the very same sinful nature that caused them to put their selfish desires between them and God. Call it original sin. Some people call it inherited or inherent sin. Some use the word concupiscence. Pretty nifty word. It means the inborn desire to defy warnings, to be the captain of your own ship and the master of your own fate. Whatever you want to call it, we've all got it. Because sin is like a pandemic disease. It's everywhere around us, and it rips through us. And unlike COVID-19, there is no vaccine, there is no effective treatment to stop its infective hold on all of us. Here's an illustration. You know, Lori, I almost always run these by you before.
Whoops.
Okay. I preach them. Didn't this time, though.
No. Okay.
When Lori and I were young, and just starting our family, we lived in a house that had a stove that was antiquated, a couple of generations behind the current technology. And the oven door had a very poorly insulated glass window. We really should have replaced it immediately, but we were young. We didn't have the money to do that, so we didn't. Instead, we repeatedly warned our little daughter, don't touch the stove, you'll get burned. We told her enough times that she would repeat the phrase, don't touch the stove, you'll get burned. Well, one day the oven was hot, and our little girl pulled herself to a standing position by leaning on the stove with her hands against that door. And we heard a terrible scream, and she began shrieking, I touched the stove! I touched the stove! We actually had to pull her away from the stove, because at that age she was unable to figure out how to get her balance and then push herself off of that. I'm pretty sure today there'd be some government intervention against such bad parenting. But it's not our negligence that I'm trying to illustrate. It's the temptation of our little toddler to test the truth of our warning that we should have expected from the moment of conception in the womb. Because we, by nature, are doubters. We are self-appointed arbiters of what the truth should be. So in her desire to control her world, it was important for her to reject the rules that had been laid down for her own safety. And yes, I have to frame again this story that we instantly knew when this happened. It was our fault. We should have moved heaven and earth if necessary to provide her with a safe environment. So doubt, even unbelief, those are really the standard in our relationship with God and with each other. That's not what we want, but that's where we're at. How can that change? Well, there would have to be some new world order to replace the one that we're stuck in. And that world order is not going to be created from something here below. It can only come from above, from where God reigns as Lord and Sovereign. And God speaks through the prophet Isaiah this morning to show us what the future will hold in this new order. It will come from the lineage of Jesse. Jesse was the father of the great King David. But it won't be the great King David. It won't even be anyone like the failed dynasty that followed him on the throne of Israel. Isaiah says it will be like a lively green branch sprouting up from a thoroughly dead stump, bringing vitality to what was once dead. This new shoot will be from that royal lineage. But he will come with the Spirit of the Lord resting upon him. He'll have the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. He will be powerful, and to the wicked he will even be fearsome. And yet he will bring righteousness and equity. And he will usher in an age that in many facets is just the opposite of what we have become accustomed to. Because of the world's traumatic fall into sin, we expect the strong to be lording it over the weak. We expect the rich to be taking advantage of the poor. Not so in this age to come. We've all been taught about how nature works, and so in this world we realize there are predators and there are prey. There are parasites and there are victims of parasites. Wolves and lambs do not make good bedfellows. Leopards do not offer goats their friendship and allegiance. Never trust a lion to take care of a young calf. Nature declares the survival of the fittest is in play, and the weak are merely fuel for the strong. But there is another way, and it is the way of the Lord's chosen servant. This servant will enter human history and present us with another reality, a reality that runs counter to the ways of this world. His reality will be peace between enemies, and harmony in a brand new nature for the people of God. The question is, will it be a reality on this present earth that we live in? Or will it be a reality that only comes in the heavenly kingdom that descends with Christ in the world that's yet to come? Well, really, it's a little of both. Jesus Christ, of course, is the shoot from the stump of his ancestor, Jesse. Jesus will come into this world with the angel chorus singing, "Glory to God in the highest and peace on earth to men of good will." Jesus will bring grace and execute God's justice at his own expense. Jesus will bring healing to the sick and sight to the blind, forgiveness to the sinful, and he will transform the lives of those who live in the fear of the Lord. For the Lord will come bearing an olive branch, putting an end to the warfare between our nature and God's nature. Jesus very well could have come with a sword. He could have simply slain all the enemies of the Lord. The question then is, who would remain standing in a world where all of us have fallen short of the goodness and glory of God? So instead, Jesus comes as a suffering servant, giving up his body and blood to be punished for the sins of a world gone haywire. People from all nations and all tribes will come to him, and he will not cast away the weak ones. Instead, he will embrace them. He will not punish the sinners, instead he will redeem them. He will open up the gates of heaven to sinners, such that those who were predators will seek out those that were prey, so that they might rejoice that their enmity is over in this new world order. This is a picture of what the new reality of life in Christ will be like. In this world, we still live in our transgressions, but now we have a hope of being released from our captivity. And in this world, we still live as either bullies or underdogs. But in the new world order, we have freedom from the violence that rules within us and between us. In Christ, the peace of the Lord entered human flesh and made good what had gone bad. The Lamb of God was sacrificed on the cross of Calvary to atone for our sins and to dwell in our hearts. From the moment then of our baptisms into Christ, we have had a new way of living, something that is not ruled by the law of the jungle. We became God's children, given a future in this new world, and called to be his agents of peace on this earth. That original sin, it still lives within us. We live in this world simultaneously as a sinner and as a saint. We have been given faith in the new live shoot of Jesus' righteousness that breaks forth from the deadness of our old human nature. And he is God's signal of his love for all people. In the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, ruler of heaven and earth. Amen. Congregation, please stand as we sing the offering. Joseph Mansky, Janet Piper, instill to all medical professionals who care for them. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear.
Stir up our hearts, O Lord, and make ready the way of your only begotten Son, who comes to us this day in his true body and precious blood for the forgiveness of our sins. May all who feast upon him do so in repentance and faith. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear.
Heavenly Father, grant that we may be kept in joy and sustained in hope through every trouble and every trial of this mortal life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Thank you.
sing together the Nunc Dimittis.
that.
Why don't we want to make it?
No, I don't know.
Christmas Eve.
Oh, okay.
So the